Okay. I'll let the last set of stragglers find their seats. Let's get started. So hi, everybody. My name is Ewen Cheslack-Postava. I'm an engineer at Confluent. And I want to talk to you today about real-time data integration at scale with Apache Kafka and Cassandra. So just about me, I said I'm an engineer at Confluent. I'm also a Kafka committer. And I'm the connect lead at Confluent. So I helped develop a lot of the framework and some of the connectors that we've published so far. So over the past probably 10, 15 years or so, we've seen sort of an explosion in the number of data systems that people are using. A lot of this is a result of sort of traditional relational databases not necessarily serving a bunch of use cases very effectively. Cassandra is a big part of that, which is why I put it up sort of front and center there. It's sort of at the forefront of the NoSQL database push. The problem with this is that now we have tons of different systems and our data is spread all over the place. This makes it really hard to actually build useful applications out of these systems when you know, you're a large enterprise, you have a bunch of these different databases, and now I need data from Cassandra mixed with something from my relational database, mixed with something from maybe my log or analytics data, and trying to tie that all together becomes really challenging. What you end up seeing are architectures that start looking something like this. It's a pretty big mess. And this is what you get if you just sort of ad hoc add things into your architecture. And this is basically what most enterprises end up with. And it's not really anybody's fault. There's just not a lot of planning. You start out with something small, one database that works well enough for your one application. Then you add in another database for some specialized type of data. And then say time series data. And now you've got it in two places. And in order to add anything into this sort of giant mess of systems requires really careful planning and oftentimes is actually organizationally really challenging. It's not even the technical challenge always that's the problem. Sometimes it's literally that I have to talk to 10 different teams to figure out who I might impact if I change anything. Adding something is actually probably the easier problem. The hardest problem is if you start way, way up at the top of that image and want to change one thing, change the schema of one piece of data, you have to figure out how that flows down through the entire rest of the system. This turns into a really, really hard problem to manage and a huge waste of time, honestly. In general, the problem that I'm getting at here is data integration. So the problem is that we need to get all of this data to the right location in order to be processed for certain types of applications. Oftentimes, that literally means actually just copying data from one data store into another data store and translating the formats, taking care of any indexing that needs to happen to make it perform well. Oftentimes, data normalization. This is sort of the general ETL story if you're used to thinking in terms of batch systems. But in general, just this process of moving data between systems is a really hard problem. And as you could see from the previous image, what you often have is sort of this, you end up with sort of n squared problem. You one off say, okay, I need data from system X and I need to get it into system Y, so I build a connector. I say, get data using this one app that I run and I have to operationalize. You do that a bunch of times and you end up with a ton of different systems, all managed differently, huge mess. So I just want to cover quickly a couple of sort of anti-patterns that we see in terms of how people approach this problem. The first one is what I was just talking about. It's the most natural way to approach this problem initially. You basically just build a bunch of ad hoc one-off systems. As I said, this leads to an n squared problem and it turns into a giant mess. The sort of other anti-pattern goes sort of all the way in the opposite direction. It says, let's just adopt a single tool that does literally everything. So it covers extraction, transformation, and load. It deals with streaming and batch data, just literally everything you can think of. I don't want to name names, but an example of a system, which actually I think is one of the better ones out there that is sort of like this, is something like Flume, which is designed to connect to everything, and it also has interceptors for transforming data, whole bunch of concepts to learn. The problem with this is that you actually basically do sort of mediocre at everything. You're not really good at extraction, you're not really good at transformation, you're not really good at loading. Transformation is a great example of this. You wouldn't use something like Flume to do complex stream processing. You would use a stream processing framework. So while you can get away with very minor, light transformations, it's not really doing everything that you need. And by introducing all these additional steps, it actually hurts the guarantees that you can get. So in particular, delivery guarantees are really hard to provide in any of these systems once you add so many layers and so many transformations, so many abstractions that sort of as you go through the entire pipeline, you have very little guarantees. The third one we see fairly often, this is becoming more and more common, especially because there are so many stream processing frameworks now, is trying to use stream processing frameworks to do this. They sort of look nice because a lot of times what people want to do is some transformation, some data munging along the way while copying data from one location to another. The problem with this is that you get very weak guarantees then with mapping that data into storage systems. So a lot of these systems have sort of pluggable components, so I can connect and write data streaming out to something like Cassandra. Unfortunately, because they have to satisfy an abstraction that sort of works across all of these storage systems, you're talking about trying to map an abstraction that works for HDFS and Cassandra. Both of those things don't have very similar interfaces, so it shouldn't be too surprising that you get very weak abstractions and very weak guarantees. The other drawback to these stream processing frameworks is that they're a huge amount of overhead just to do something very light. If you really just need that light transformation, you're deploying something like a Spark cluster just to copy data from one location to another. You're dedicating a bunch of compute nodes for basically no reason because they're doing very lightweight transformation. So overall, the problem I'm getting at here is that we have sort of a lack of balance. We have sort of two ends of the spectrum really well covered by a bunch of different systems. We have ad hoc, and we have sort of the do everything, cover everything ETL case. So the problem is we don't really have any separation of concerns here. And what we've been trying to tackle with Kafka Connect is something that sits a little bit more in the middle there and is more well-balanced and doesn't honestly try to tackle everything. We leave transformation to other systems. So I want to take a step back. I'm going to talk in more depth about Kafka Connect and introduce sort of more details and exactly what it provides in a few minutes. Since not everybody here may be deeply familiar with Kafka, I want to introduce it first and also sort of what the sort of architecture that we suggest using around Kafka. So Kafka, the idea of Kafka is that it's going to provide a distributed, large-scale pub-sub messaging system. It doesn't look quite like sort of traditional messaging systems. It's designed for very high throughput, very large scale. But what you can do is sort of use this as your central data storage system, where all of your data is going to flow through here, and then use it to sort of exchange data between different systems, and as a central location where you can sort of define formats of data, and then also apply transformation. So you can see here at the top we have maybe data coming in from apps, from databases like Cassandra. We could pipe that in data directly from there. It doesn't have to be coming directly from an app. Other data stores as well. We have it sort of flowing into Kafka, and that gives a point where everybody else who wants access to that data has sort of a standard location to get it and get sort of all of the real-time data that's available in your company. Off to the side, you can see we can pull data off of there, and because it's PubSub, we can consume the data many times. So we'll pull data off, we'll do some sort of analytics, we'll do some sort of stream processing. It actually might loop back. So on the right-hand side here, you can see that we have a stream processing framework where we pull data out, process it, maybe do aggregations, do some sort of complex computation on it, and then bring it back into Kafka, which then makes that derived data available for multiple consumers as well. And finally, the sort of traditional path that most people end up using is that eventually it goes down into some data warehouse or some sort of long-term storage. And actually, in our case, I'll come back to this later, it could actually be Cassandra down there as well. So Cassandra could be both at the top and bottom of this image. Okay, but what does Kafka actually provide? So, that's out of order. Kafka, from sort of a 10,000-foot view, does look actually like a sort of traditional message queue in the sense that we have a set of broker servers. We have a set of producers that generate messages. In Kafka, these can be key value pairs. They go into the brokers, get stored, get replicated, and they then can be consumed. And because it's pub-sub, multiple consumers downstream can consume it. There are a couple of interesting things about Kafka. In particular, one of the reasons why it's really high performance is that it's designed around this log data structure. This is sort of very fundamental. Sequential writes to this log are going to be very efficient. Even on old magnetic disks, you get very high performance from this. as I said, it's pub-sub, so we can have multiple consumers, and their sort of reference point for where they're still consuming data from can be completely different. They don't have to start at the same time. One of the things that differs here is that from a lot of traditional message queues is that this is a persistent queue where you can go back and read data from scratch, even if you weren't, you know, available when the data was initially written. And so you can see here that when we read off data, the two destination systems can read copies of the same data. Okay, so if you had a single log, that's not going to actually be very high performance. You can't distribute that or scale it very effectively. So we further sort of add scalability to the system by making a topic a partitioned log. So rather than sort of a single log, we have n of them, and that's configurable. You can change it over time, but generally you would fix it once and then use that permanently, fix that number once. What this means is that producers now have to choose where they're going to send data. One important thing here is that the where you put the data is going to affect how consumption ultimately works. So in particular, the most common way of figuring out where to put data is that you have some key, say maybe a user ID, and you would use that key to figure out which partition. This actually happens automatically under the hood, but the mechanics here are a little bit important. And then downstream consumers can consume from all the topics, and they can consume in parallel. Each of these partitions is also replicated for data security. This is sort of, you know, the standard now with most data systems. So what's really interesting about Kafka is actually its consumption model, though. So a lot of this sounds like, you know, maybe a pretty standard storage system. The consumption model is interesting because it automatically handles sort of scaling up and scaling down. So Kafka has what's called a consumer group. And when you consume data from multiple consumers in the same consumer group, they just sort of like split up the load. They say, I'll take partition, you know, consumer one will take partitions one and two, and consumer two will take partitions three and four, and things just automatically work. The nice thing is this also coordinates automatically. So if one of those goes away or you decide you need to scale up the number of workers because the processing is too expensive, that'll just work. Just start up another process and it'll join. They'll sort of rebalance the work and things just scale up. Okay, so that's sort of the very quick rundown of what Kafka is providing. So as I said, real-time data, scalable, this flexible consumption model. And putting this sort of at the heart of your real-time data systems can allow you this like convenient point to provide coordination between not only different apps, but literally different teams in your organization. So one of the nice things about moving to an architecture that looks more like this is that now that we have Kafka in the center and sort of acting as that coordination point, it acts as a buffer between teams. So you can also sort of centrally track the format of data, deal with schema issues, compatibility issues in a structured way that makes it really easy for teams to sort of remain decoupled. If I want to change something, I change it in a way that I know is compatible, and that makes it so that all downstream consumers are never affected. So it allows you to scale your organization as well as just your data. Okay, so we've got this sort of at the center. We've got it connecting to apps. Apps might use producers directly, and so that seems pretty good. But now what about all these other data systems? I said we can connect to all of those other data systems, pull data, say, in from Cassandra or push data out to Cassandra. How does that work? So for a long time, there was no real framework for doing this. And so what people ended up doing was building a lot of ad hoc tools. You can go out to GitHub and you'll find a lot of things called Kafka connectors, which are just sort of one-off tools that somebody said, I want to connect to system X. And they built a custom tool. If you go out and try and use those, you're, you know, productionalizing, operationalizing a whole bunch of different tools in order to get these things all connected. So what I'm going to go into more detail about now is Kafka Connect, which is our framework for data import and export for Kafka. So this is a relatively recent development. It was released last year. But we're actually making great strides in getting a lot of connectors, one for Cassandra, which I'll talk about in a couple minutes. So what were the goals with Kafka Connect? We could just keep on building these one-off ad hoc tools, but we identified a lot of problems with them, so we wanted to fix as many of these as possible. So the first is that we focus purely on copying data. This is actually really, really, really important. As I mentioned before, you get much weaker semantics if you don't focus on this only. We wanted batteries included, so as much stuff as we can take out of the hands of connector developers as possible, we want the framework to just handle it for you. The third is to standardize a bunch of stuff. We want to make sure that that all connectors get sort of a uniform interface for doing things like configuration, metrics, monitoring, and so on. The fourth item is parallelism. We want to make sure that we enable parallelism by default. This is really important. A lot of connector systems, because they're written without some supporting structure, end up being very simplistic, and you can't actually scale them to large data sets. And the fifth, which the fourth is an enabler of, is that we want to, by default, support large-scale data. Okay, so what does it look like if we want to copy data from Cassandra? So, and in this case, I'm going to build sort of a small pipeline from Cassandra to HDFS. So if we have a table of data, we use some, let's say we have the data in this sample, just a single column, and then we have a timestamp associated with it. The idea is that we're going to convert this based on some ordering. In this case, the timestamp gets a little bit more complicated than that if you want to very, very carefully define the ordering. But we define an ordering on the table so that we can copy the data and convert it into a stream. This is sort of the fundamental problem that Kafka Connect does. It defines a data model, which you have to map to. And once you map to that streaming data model, we can get that data into Kafka. So in this case, the top half is a source from Cassandra. We're going to use timestamps to order that. The second half is a sync to HDFS. In that case, we can do things like buffer data for batch systems like HDFS. Kafka is really good at that. And in this case, we convert a stream into a set of files, which is a fairly natural transformation. So the fundamental data model that we follow is called a partition stream. If you remember what Kafka looked like, this actually looks very similar, and that was very intentional. For sync connectors, which are the one in the previous example, the one going to HDFS from Kafka, this is natural because the input is just from Kafka, and so the partition stream model is natural. The more difficult case is when you're trying to map to something in to this model from a source connector, which doesn't necessarily map very easily. Cassandra is actually a good example of that. Most relational databases are, most databases are, and so. In this case, as I mentioned, we can use timestamps to do some, at least, rough ordering there. And with a sort of slightly more complex model, we can get exact modeling or exact mapping. And the key thing there is that we have some sort of mapping, and then with the ordered stream, we get some set of offsets that we can use. This is like the basic thing that connectors need to do. And then because we provide this model, the framework takes care of a whole bunch of other stuff for you. So. In particular, it deals with figuring out how to schedule stuff. Once you've generated sort of that list of streams, you can map it to a set of tasks. Those tasks are sort of categorized under the connector. So if we had 10 input tables, we can easily just specify that to the framework, get the tasks, get it split among different tasks, and it handles the scheduling for you. There are sort of two ways to run this then. Those tasks and connectors don't actually, I didn't define any physical execution. Each one of those is actually associated with a single thread in the framework. The two ways that you can execute this are either in standalone mode or in distributed mode. So standalone mode, usually not as helpful, and for example, not going to be as helpful with Cassandra. But it is useful in some cases, like log files, where you actually want a sort of agent on each machine picking up the logs and then just pushing them to Kafka. That standalone mode is trivial. It just starts up a process, starts up all the tasks. The second way you can run it is distributed mode. And I mentioned that we manage scheduling automatically to tasks. We also manage scheduling to individual processes. So this work gets automatically split up across the workers. And if something dies, we rebalance all of that work automatically. So this makes it robust to failures. You don't really have to worry that much about sort of managing or maintaining it and monitoring it. You of course, want to. But when something fails, as long as you have something that brings back up that process, the other worker will eventually recover, whenever you recover from the failure, and you'll be able to proceed sort of automatically. So it's basically as long as you're running under like Supervisor D or Mesos or whatever, that's fine. That actually brings up another point though too, which is that we don't care how you manage that process. We do all of this internally among the processes. They self-coordinate. It's all done through Kafka automatically, so you don't really have to worry we don't have to worry about how you manage your processes. We don't have to assume you're running in Yarn or Mesos or whatever. We actually don't even have to assume that you'll recover. If you don't monitor your processes and one dies, we'll just move the work around and that's fine. We're not worried about the number of processes there. Okay, so you've got distributed mode, you've got standalone mode. I want to talk a little bit about delivery guarantees as well, because these are pretty important. This is something that a lot of frameworks that copy data around tend to miss, and ad hoc connectors almost never have this properly tested or verified. So in terms of delivery guarantees, Kafka Connect can manage all of the offsets for you automatically. And so what that means is because we have this partition stream, if something dies, as long as we saved the offset that we were at, we're able to sort of rewind and go back and start replaying from that point. And so what this means is that even in the face of failure, we can make sure that all of your data ultimately gets delivered. The framework manages the sort of offset commit process, so you don't really have to think about this. The key thing you have to do is just provide some offsets. As I said, with something like Cassandra, it'd be basically like the timestamp column. The default for the framework is at least one semantic, so that means that all of your data is definitely going to get there as long as you wait for failures to be resolved, but you might see duplicates. The reason for this is that there is no way for a framework by itself to guarantee better semantics than that without some coordination from the destination system. And so we actually do support exactly once, and there's some guidance as to how to actually achieve that in different connectors, but you need to provide a little bit of support in your connector as well. I want to mention one other feature that's pretty important about the framework and something that you miss a lot with ad hoc connectors, and that's converters. So this is basically serializers. We had to use a different name because serializers was already taken within Kafka. But it boils down to we separate out and abstract the serialization format that you use with Kafka from any format used by the connector. And so an example of this would be that data is coming from Cassandra, and you select it with SQL, and then you get back out some data format in a runtime format. There's no serialization format that would work directly with Kafka there. Instead of just sort of assuming one format, we abstract it out so that any connector writes to an abstract data API, and then serialization happens separately. This means for free, when we write a connector, we get serialization into any of the formats. So this means that, which I'm coming to now, the connector that Confluent, DataStax, and Data Mountaineer just announced today as certified already supports a bunch of serialization formats because they basically comes for free. So we just announced this morning. It provides both a source and sync, and so what that means is you can get data either from Cassandra into Kafka or from Kafka into Cassandra. I think likely the sync is the more popular one. It's already distributed and scalable. If just to give you an idea of sort of what the how much the framework is providing, I believe it took Data Mountaineer maybe a couple of months of developer time to end up building this, and then we did a bunch of certification and testing around it. There are a bunch of all the data types and everything are already supported. Coming sort of soon in a future version is better support for table schema evolution, which will improve the sort of data compatibility story. Okay, I did want to mention that aside from Kafka Connect is a general framework. We spent a bunch of time building and testing the Cassandra implementation. We also do a bunch of other certifications of connectors. There's a link at the end on the last slide for this page. So we have a bunch certified already. We also have a bunch of community ones. And that's really the goal here, is we want to enable other people to build connectors that that can feed data into or out of Kafka. So I just want to come back to this slide one last time. And sort of now that you've got sort of the picture of what all the pieces can do, sort of emphasize that there's actually only a couple of pieces in this picture. So you've got, of course, all the data systems at the top, which are probably the major source of all of your data. You've got Kafka in the middle. All of those arrows at the top and the arrows down to Hadoop and Data Warehouse, those are basically Kafka connectors. And what we'd like to see is just have all of those lines be just deploy a Kafka connector, send it to the Kafka Connect cluster, and you're done. The only other major pieces there are actually apps that consume data, consume and serve data directly, which is something like real-time analytics. And then on the other side, something like stream processing, which generates derived data, for which you use a stream processing framework. There are a bunch. We suggest Kafka Streams. With that, I'd like to thank you and take questions. There's links to for downloads to if you want to try some of this stuff out. There's a link to what we call the connector hub there. You can download the Cassandra connector from there, as well as a bunch of other connectors. And I should just do a shout out that we have a booth if you wanna chat. Our CEO is doing a book signing and later today. And I would be remiss if I did not say we're hiring. Okay, thanks. How does which piece of it compare to Spark? Are you talking about Spark streaming? Are you talking about stream processing frameworks? Or are you talking about copying data? Spark streaming. Okay, so not the subject of this talk. The question was how does Kafka compare to Spark streaming? I'll give a quick major differentiator that I would highlight is that the piece that you're really talking about is Kafka Streams, which is the stream processing layer that we built on top of Kafka. The main differentiator there is that you can deploy it like a normal app and you write it like a normal app. It's not sort of the operationalization mode for Kafka streaming is really deploy a Kafka, or not Kafka streaming, for Spark streaming, is deploy a cluster of nodes and you submit jobs to it. The model for Kafka Streams is much more like write an application and deploy it like you normally would under whatever your deployment, Puppet, Chef, Mesos, whatever. And it scales up and down sort of automatically using the underlying clients. The other major differentiator is that Kafka Streams is actually a much tinier framework because we leverage the existing clients. And so the framework is actually quite small. What you need for stream processing is much smaller than what most people think. Most of the code in those other systems is about connecting to other systems and providing the sort of scheduling infrastructure that we just sort of pass on to whatever you normally use. Yeah, you got a mic coming.
Yeah, my question is, when you say Kafka connector, use Cassandra as a data source. Mm-hmm. If that table is live, like new events keep coming, how do you pick up those?
Yeah. So the basic idea here is that you have to provide some ordering on the events. So you can use the timestamp to determine this. So basically, every time you query, let me give sort of two ways that you can accomplish this. The way that the connector does it today is that you query using normal queries, and you just ask for everything past whatever the last set of data that you saw was. So you have some ordering constraint there, which does mean that like if you like with updates and stuff, you have to make sure that there's a way to detect that. There is actually also a bulk mode, so if you just want to do periodic bulk dumps of the table, you can do that. But for the incremental mode, it detects it by having the timestamp column sort for it. The other way that I'd love to see done eventually, although it's generally a much, much larger integration, or development challenge, is actually feeding directly off like replication logs. Most data storage systems ultimately have a log at sort of the base of the system, and so if you can tap directly into that, you can get data a little bit more directly. The other benefit of that is that you don't have to poll, so you can get it sort of much lower latency than you do with the polling mechanism that's used today.
You don't have to poll. You don't have to.
The connector today will poll, so it has a polling interval.
You have to schedule.
You can keep that. You can keep that very short. Sorry.
You have to schedule interval to poll. Or?
Yeah. There's a default though. I don't remember exactly what it is. It might be 1 second by default or something. So it's quite low, and you can make it as low as you want as long as you're willing to pay the overhead of running that query.
Okay.
But I was just saying that an alternative, which I'd love to see built someday, is to feed directly off of the sort of activity log that you get automatically out of these systems.
Okay, thanks.
Do you have a preferred long-term storage mechanism for these kind of like log entries? I feel like maybe a time series database or something of that nature would be good. I mean, obviously something like Cassandra is great if you have a particular business requirement in mind, but mm-hmm. for when stuff falls off the end of the Kafka queue, where do you like to keep that?
I mean, probably by far the most popular destination will just be HDFS. But to be honest, no preferred solution. It's basically whatever works for you. And there are different requirements, like you said. So time series database might be really great if your data is structured that way. If your data is not structured that way, it's probably not the best solution, right? So it really just depends on the type of data. Time series database may end up being eventually a sort of preferred method just because you get timestamp information now as of, I'm forgetting whether it was 09 or 010, but as of one of those, you get timestamp information from Kafka for free, so it sort of fits in naturally. The only caveat there is that you need something that does cold data storage well too, generally. Generally, this is going to something, you know, pretty permanent. So. But again, HDFS is probably the most popular. We have a great connector for it. So, yeah.
Kafka has limit on message size, so
Sure. Well, so, well, one thing. Sorry, the question for those who may not have heard is that there are limits on Kafka message size. So, what happens if you try to copy data that is too large? The sort of easy answer to that is that it'll fail. It might allow retries, but it'll eventually fail. Kafka does have limits on data size, but generally, what you would want to do is just make sure that if you have large data entries, you can bump that up on a per topic basis. So, what that would amount to is a little bit of manual intervention in order to bump up the message size to if your data is too large. Other than that, it's going to log an error message and complain, which is by the way, also just what Kafka will do anyway for in any situation. Yeah. Yeah. Specifically for Cassandra or? Okay. The question is about exactly one semantics. This is actually you have to tread carefully in these discussions because different people mean different things by exactly one sometimes. In stream processing frameworks, exactly one's processing means something different than exactly one's delivery would mean in a data storage system. So we are working on better semantics for Kafka. The sort of fundamental limiting factor there is that on the producer side, just for all systems built on top of the protocol, currently the producer is limited in how it can do, like the broker basically doesn't do deduplication. So that's a sort of limitation, and that's something that we're working on improving across the board. And this will apply then, that filters up into both Kafka Connect and Kafka Streams, both of which need some additional integration work to really make it work well at those layers. So, the exactly one semantics that I'm talking about here is specifically for Kafka Connect and specific connectors. And the reason that's possible for some connectors is the HDFS connector is a good example. Actually, Cassandra is a good example too. We have a unique ID for every single message because it has a topic, it has a partition, and it has an offset. And that tuple forms a unique ID. That's enough that a downstream system, given that information, can deduplication and therefore only deliver the data once as long as it can figure that out. And so, you know, Cassandra, you could do that in as well. I mean, you can do the sort of deduplication there. And so we generally do that. It just requires the connector to have a little bit of extra smarts. So I guess the key thing is the exactly one semantics that's a larger long-term project is sort of Kafka talking to Kafka, whereas the exactly one semantics I'm talking about here is about Kafka talking to another data system. We have a lot of questions left. I'm not sure how much time we have, but I will also be around after the session, so you can catch up with me after that in the back.
I couldn't look up online. Serialization, does it work with proto buffs or not?
We don't. Confluent hasn't built a proto buff serializer yet, but it would not be hard to. The major thing that you usually end up needing there is that you'll need some sort of centralized schema registry, which Confluent has for Avro, and we built the Avro serializers. But building the converters, that serialization layer is straightforward. It's just data translation. So okay. I'd imagine someone will write one soon. And actually, I'd love to see the same thing for Thrift as well.
Awesome. Thanks.
Cool. Yeah. So the question is, does Kafka Connect deal with back pressure? So Kafka Connect deals with back pressure sort of automatically because Kafka handles back pressure for us. There's not strictly speaking back pressure because you're using Kafka as the storage system. So I guess on the store side, if the back pressure would be if for some reason you can't contact Kafka. Kafka itself doesn't really have back pressure, it just accepts data and writes it to disk, and then you wait as long as you need to get an ACK. So in that sense, there's back pressure in that you'll wait for the data to come back. We have a certain amount of buffering and we'll block if the buffer fills. On the sync side, back pressure would mean that your destination system for some reason is not accepting data fast enough anymore, and Kafka will buffer for that, right? Your input is from Kafka, so there's nothing to respond to. It's just that you read data as fast as you can. Yes, yeah. Which is, by the way, what Kafka was built for, so. Yeah. Sorry, for? We don't support it directly. I'm not sure that there are any adapters currently. I would not think of Kafka necessarily. It can serve this purpose for some applications, but I wouldn't think of it as a traditional message queuing system. It's not designed to support quite the same set of features. So for example, filtering data in topics, you never filter data on the broker side in Kafka. You just consume all the data, and if you want to filter, you filter on the client side. So there's no like built-in support for those pieces. Yes. Yes. The other way to do it would be to just build an AMQP adapter, which we have a. So, for example, we have a REST proxy for languages that don't have good client support. It actually has historically been difficult to write challenging to write clients for Kafka because it's a protocol and the fact that in the sort of older implementation, you had to interact directly with Zookeeper, which is like relatively complicated from, say, like if you're writing a JavaScript client. So we wrote a REST proxy, and so you can definitely adapt to other protocols. I'd love to see like MQTT added to that as well. There's a bunch of protocols that would be, options for adapters. The other thing that you can do is also work with something like JMS. I mean, obviously not everybody's using Java, but you can easily build sort of, JMS connectors for Kafka as well. Yeah, sorry, how much time do we have? Done? Okay, cool. Thanks, guys. I'll catch more questions outside.